Hey everybody, how's it going? Welcome, welcome. Hopefully everybody's having a great night tonight. I'm not going to take too much time to get into everything here. I do need to very obviously start this out with this will be a very spoiler-filled stream. So if you have not yet finished the 1.4 questline, you should probably do that and come back and watch this later. It will be available again for replay later, so make sure that you don't blow this one up, because this questline had a lot of big reveals. There was a lot of stuff going on, and I'm really looking forward to getting into all of this here. And you can kind of expect that this will be a new and consistent stream format for the channel. I'm probably going to be moving away a little bit from the standard gameplay streams and more into content focused streams that are a lot shorter than the previous ones. And if everybody wants me to still continue gameplay streams, then I may still explore that, but in a different channel in the future. With all that said, I'm gonna start getting into the actual content here of the story that we just went through, which was pretty huge. We got 1.4, and it seemed like things were going to go a little bit slower to start. And then this week, we finally got the quest to drop, where Dansliff comes back into things. Of course, the whole thing starts out in Liyue, and, you know, you get kind of like this red herring introduction for the treasure hoarders. And so, as the treasure hoarders are kind of built up, like, it seems like they're making or setting up an operation against the Spiral Abyss, or the Abyssal Order specifically. And it kind of makes it think, like, you know, okay, these guys are going to show up. They're going to, you know, we're actually going to maybe get some development from these characters in the treasure hoarders. But, you know, they go so far as to introduce these characters, Big Sis and also the Great Thief from Fontaine, which, you know, like, you think this Grand Thief is going to be somebody big. And, you know, you set out to these ruins, and that's not what happens at all. So we end up getting to the ruins. We're expecting, you know, from the trailers and everything, we're going to be running into the Abyss Herald as well. And, you know, the Abyss Herald ends up being somewhat of a red herring as well. And in case you don't really know what a red herring is, it's basically a story element that is made to make you think that it's going to be something that's very important, very pivotal, and then it isn't. It's meant to mislead you, to distract you from what was actually important, what was actually going on. So the big reveal for the Grand Thief from Fontaine, after, you know, them building up his reputation, and from Fontaine, was just for him to be found dead in front of the altar inside the ruin. So not only do they come up on this guy being dead, but he looked like he died horribly, didn't he? He's on his knees, he's gnarled over in what looked to be, you know, like he was in pain or in anguish of some kind. That's something we haven't really had a whole lot going through yet in this game. You know, like, they've not been afraid to tell us that characters have died in the stories, but we haven't watched or come up on characters who are dead. And of course, our characters actually, you know, we play through the game and we kill people as we go through, but, you know, they're enemies, so they don't really count. But we didn't know this treasure hoarder guy outside of the fact that he was the Grand Thief, and there he was. He died horribly, and that was probably one of the darker moments that the game has had so far. Really, if you look back at everything we've seen so far, that is far and away the darkest moment that we've had so far. That guy definitely died in horrible, horrible anguish, and they just left him there. So we don't know exactly how he was killed, but we know that it wasn't great. You know, and he's here in front of this altar, which is on screen now. And it's got the upside down suspended statue of the Seven, which we find out later in the quest was stolen from somewhere in Mondstadt many, 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 many years ago. We're not actually given a specific time when that statue had actually disappeared. All we were told about the loss of the statue was that it was so long ago that nobody really talks about it anymore. So that's not really the most descriptive definition to have been given regarding what happened to it exactly. But we do know that, you know, that it was taken and that nobody talks about it. So there's not really a whole lot to go on there. So with all that said, it's kind of easy to assume that at the very least, it's been a while. If nobody's talking about it anymore, it's not a mystery. The people of Mondstadt are pretty attached to their Statues of the Seven, just like every other nation in Teyvat. So you kind of have to think that this has larger implications as well. It means that the Spiral Abyss has more than likely, or not the Spiral Abyss, the Abyssal Order has been playing the long game for quite some time. And it's probably likely that they've also been playing the long game with the assistance of Lamine for all of this time as well, which is very interesting as well. And so there's definitely larger implications to that. So like I said, it seems like they're playing the long game. We don't know when they stole it, but they did. And so they have it strung up upside down in this place. And the Abyss Herald and the other Abyss agents there are trying to guard it, keep it out of the hands of the rest of the world, trying to prevent it from being discovered by anybody. So long as it isn't discovered, then they don't really have a problem. But what it does have, as opposed to just the stone orb in its hand, is this large glowing shadow orb being held instead. Which is like it's not doing anything, but it is there at the time. So we find out later from Dainsleif, after they leave the ruin, that this is more than likely, I think they called it a loom, which they are using, or he seems like he has this idea from the talisman that they find on this Abyss Mage, that they're going to reverse engineer the first guardian, or ruined guardian, or what the ancient Kenrians called field tillers, which was just a code name for the actual weapons, because I guess, you know, massive, you know, like I guess maybe walker with missiles isn't, you know, gonna sound great, so they called it field tiller, or, you know, now they just call them ruins guardians because they seem to all be attracted to the ancient ruins of the world that once remained. But this isn't the only interesting thing that Dainsleif dropped on us, right? He also revealed to us that Conria was actually the origination of all of the Ruined Guardians, and also the origination point of the Abyss Order. So, you know, this kind of goes a lot deeper than I was expecting us to get into at this point in time. So what we have with this reveal is, for one, he confirmed that Conria was destroyed 500 years ago. So those of you who have been following my channel for a while now know that I set out a theory for the 500 years apart idea back around the same, I believe, within a week or so of the game's release. It might have been I think it was just before or just after the game released. And for me, them being 500 years apart, and by them I mean the siblings, was basically canon. And now we know that that's true. Aether revealed that he had seen Conria destroyed, that he knew that that's what that was, and he has all this time known that that's what it was. He wasn't really shy about that. He didn't really beat around the bush about it after Paimon and Dainsleif began to question him on this. So, with that said, Conria was destroyed 500 years ago. So that means all of the ancient text, all of the ruin guards, ruin graders, all of these enemies are ancient weapons of Conria. And Dainsleif tells us that the ancient Conria, or it's Conria, was a once great society of humanity. And it wasn't, they didn't rely on the gods. They didn't rely on the Seven. And not only that, they were almost more successful than the other nations of Teyvat. They had, you know, ridiculous technological advances that other nations didn't have. And they were accomplishing this without worshiping the Seven. And this brought wrath upon them. He didn't actually say the Seven is what brought destruction upon them, but what he did say was that the gods saw fit to destroy Conria for their non-worshipping ways, basically for saying that they dared not worship the gods. They were destroyed. So Aether's immediate response to this, you know, I refer to Aether because he is my chosen protagonist. So Aether immediately says something along the lines of, I'm going to have to talk to Venti and Zhongli. As a response to that, well, he doesn't say it out loud because he hasn't really let on to Dainsleif that he knows Barbados and that he knows Zhongli, but he now knows that those characters may have had something to do with the destruction of Conria, which was horrible. You know, Aether witnessed that himself all that time ago. So he knows that it's nothing that could be possibly sugarcoated. This is something that he went through. You know, the Sustainer of Heavenly Principles appeared before them right before they could leave. You know, they showed up in Teyvat in a meteorite of some kind, which is something that we didn't know before. And this is going to open up a whole new idea as well, this meteorite, because we didn't really have a good idea before how they were traveling through the lands. But now it seems as if their traveling through the lands method is, or, you know, traveling through the worlds rather, is, you know, they're traveling inside of, you know, like some sort of meteorite, possibly in some form of suspended animation. Because when they landed in Teyvat, Lamine woke up first, and then she had to wake up Aether before, you know, he could begin to process what had happened. I'm sure the roles change based on who you're playing. So it's not necessarily always going to be Aether. It's not necessarily always going to be Lamine. It's going to swap. But so now we know the form for which they travel. And that, I believe, is the form that we see at the beginning of the game. The two four-pointed stars that fly over Mondstadt and Lua right at the beginning. And so it seems like, yeah, that they're traveling in some sort of suspended animation within these meteors when they go between the worlds. So they're not just traveling instantaneously between these worlds. They're not opening a door or a portal to these other worlds. They're, you know, they're playing the long game as well. They're traveling slowly through space to other worlds, it seems like, which is an interesting concept if you look back at kind of how Honkai Third Impact has kind of developed, like the idea of like the arc and all that stuff. I believe that this actually could be a more compelling tie into all of that, but I've got to get more into that lore before I really start trying to dig into that stuff too. So after we found out that Aether had memories of Kenria, and that he's just been holding, you know, withholding all of that from us all this time. We also find out that the loom that they were, that the Abyss Order was putting together, they lacked the final piece that they needed in order to complete the vessel that they're trying to put together. They're basically trying to create an artificial god, and they are trying to do that by combining the power of the first Ruin Guardian or Field Tiller with the power of Osile, the, you know, the water archon or hydro god that was locked or underneath the stone spears at the, you know, Guyon Stone Forest. So that's a really interesting revelation as well. It means that, you know, the Abyssal Order may have the power to, you know, basically turn anything against anyone. This introduces kind of this idea of, you know, mind control to some degree. And I have some interesting thoughts about where that might be going. But I'm not going to get into the mind control thing too much here tonight, because I'm actually in process of writing a theory about where I think that's going. But I do think that there is a strong likelihood that, you know, the Abyssal Order, but not just the Abyssal Order, but also the gods of Celestia have the ability to control other individuals. So, and especially now that we know that they could basically take the limbs, supposedly, off of Osile, attach them to this loom with the eye of the first, with the eye of the first Field Tiller, and change it into a god of unlimited power, seemingly the one that they believe is strong enough to topple the throne of Celestia. So it, you know, Dainsleif comes to the determination that they're going to need to stop that. That cannot be allowed to continue. That they should go to the ruin and destroy that relic. And, you know, that seems like a pretty logical idea. You know, like I said, the Abyssal Order had been playing the long game. They stole that statue God knows how long. They clearly need it for something. Those statues have a sacred power of some kind that, you know, even the travelers can resonate with and absorb those powers from them. So there's something innate about those statues that allows them to repurpose them. It allows them to chip off some kind of celestial magic that, you know, will allow them to, you know, imbue a, you know, basically create a god of their own, which is an interesting concept. It's not something that I don't think anybody really saw coming with all of that. Something else that I did notice that was interesting, it was brought up not too long after this point in the story, because shortly after we get through this part of the game, they go back to the ruin. And when they go back to the ruin, basically the first thing that happens when you get back in there is that you end up fighting the Abyss Herald again. And when you get there, this scene happens. So this wasn't exactly the reveal we all expected, or at least not in the, didn't exactly play out the way that I think anybody would have guessed. It ended up being significantly more impactful. I think most of us were really expecting that they were, that Lumine was going to show up, take the Abyss Herald away, and then it would be over. We wouldn't be seeing the, you know, an actual interaction between Lumine and Aether right away. But that's not what happened at all. Not only did the two of them have an exchange, an interaction, but, you know, they kind of didn't, you know, they immediately disagreed. Aether kind of can't believe what he's seeing. He keeps asking questions like, what, you know, why are you being weird? Why are you being this way? She keeps asking him questions why he's with Dainsleif. And we find out that Dainsleif is also of Kenrian origination. He was a royal guard of Kenria who went by the name of Twilight's Sword. And so he failed to protect Kenria, and for his failure was cursed with immortality, forcing him to watch his nation burn around him, watch the people that he was sworn to protect be transformed into the monsters that they would become. And so they also, and I don't know if anybody else noticed this, they were very careful again to mention specifically the words, how exactly did they word this? It was, hang on, I wrote it down. I'm just kidding. So they were saying that his soul was stained with bloodshed. So again, they get into this idea of the blood-stained knight. And so this to me, I don't think was a confirmation that he is the blood-stained Iron Knight, but I think it kind of was. I think that they're still giving us subtle hints that he's the blood-stained Iron Knight. So this was another one of those situations where it definitely supported theories that I've been building up, just like the 500 years theory. I think we're just a little short of being able to confirm it at this time, but we're getting closer. I feel like they used those words intentionally, and they used them in quick succession. It wasn't like they were broken up into different parts of the story. They were literally spoken in the same sentence right next to each other. So I'm thinking that that's again who this was, and you know that Dainsleif is the name that he took afterwards. Remember that if you've watched my The Gnostic Course is a Lie theory, you know that I brought up the idea based on his name, Dainsleif, that he's the disdainful heir. So he's the heir to Kenria. He's the one remaining survivor at this point of Kenria, who's not a monster. Although, there's an interesting thought, right? So we know that we do have one other person from Kenria, and that would be Kaya. And we don't know exactly what his role to play is yet. But we do know during the Windbloom Festival that he maybe wasn't as kind in his poem as it initially seemed on the surface. So with that said, we also know that Mona has an interesting insight on Kaya as well, saying that he thinks he made a clean break, but he has a decision to make yet. And I think that somebody is going to force him to make a hard choice at some point in the future. And I think that someone's going to be Lamine. She's going to know who he is. She's going to know what he's done and why he was there. She may have even been directly related in why he was in Mondstadt spying on the City of Freedom in the first place. That is part of his backstory. That's a known element from Kaya's actual lore stories. If you've gotten to Friendship Level 6 or if you've done a little research, he was a spy planted in Mondstadt to watch the Ragnvinder family. That's Diluc's family. Which is why the two of them aren't on the best of terms now, even though they still are kind of brothers, or adoptive brothers, most specifically. That was really interesting, yeah, that he was revealed to be what I think is still going to be the Bloodstained Knight. We get into this idea of Kaya, but we also have an interesting thought that Paimon brings up, which is that the Lamine may not actually be the highest ranking member of the Abyssal Order. So the Abyss Herald refers to her as Princess. But Princess isn't Queen, it's not the king. So who could be above Lamine? in the Spiral Abyss. We don't know. We don't have any information about that at all. So we have this, you know, we have this, again, interesting idea that was introduced to us that, okay, maybe Lumine's not the be-all and all of the Spiral Abyss. She actually might just be a means to an end. Somebody in the Spiral Abyss might be using her or coercing her in some way to kind of take control of things here. So that we've got a lot to go with that still, but it, you know, there's still obviously more to learn from this, I believe. So as the quest line continues to progress beyond that scene, it moves into this one.
So we'll meet again. Though we need not rush, brother. I have more than enough time to wait for you. We have always had enough time.
So, this scene was a little loaded as well. If you kind of think about the things that she said, we have Lumine introducing this idea of she's always had enough time. Well, we know that she's lived in Teyvat now for 500 years without Aether. We know that she's been basically running the Spiral Abyss or running the Abyssal Order for all this time. She's more than likely critical, central to the plot of this Dark Loom, this, you know, this upside down statue of the Seven that's hanging in this altar. But she also said, we've always had enough time. Those words were definitely very meaningful, I think. And I think that she is making a subtle implication that Aether and Lumine are actually immortals, that they are actually some form of gods themselves, that they know that they are some form of gods, something that's a little bit more special than the typical humans, that they just don't let on to other people. It was also proven to us in this questline that Aether and Lumine, specifically our own chosen protagonist, is not beyond withholding certain amounts of information from everybody else around them. Because he witnessed the destruction of Khunria, and he hasn't been asking questions to Venti. He hasn't been asking questions to Zheng Li. He's just been kind of passing over that all this time and kind of let it go. So they've introduced a lot of interesting ideas. Aether and Lumine are probably immortals. Lumine is probably not the leader of the Abyssal Order, but she is dedicated to toppling the throne of Celestia. She, like the rest of the Abyssal Order, are dedicated to toppling Celestia because they destroyed Khunria. The Spiral Abyss, I keep saying the Spiral Abyss, the Abyssal Order is basically revenge bent to undo, I guess, in some weird way, what was done. So they are basically committing atrocities with, I guess, good intention, but they're not really going about doing it in the right way, obviously. So this was definitely, there was a lot of interesting twists. But now that we know that Aether and Lumine are basically immortal beings, by saying that we've always had enough time, she's not worried that she's not going to have time. She's not even concerned that somebody can stop her. She hasn't seen her brother in 500 years. She looks him in the eyes and says, bye. That was big. She's like, hey, you know, that was one thing that I was wrong about. You know, in my 500 years apart theory, I was right about a lot of things in that theory, but I thought for sure that she wouldn't want to look him in the eyes and let him know what she was doing. But she did. She did come right out and say, this is who I've thrown my lot in with. And if you don't like it, well, too bad. I'm out of here. And so she leaves. And, you know, all Aether can do is, you know, stay behind and kind of just try to process what had happened. And there's a lot to unpack with that scene. I mean, on the surface level, there were some interesting things as well. We did get to see Dainsleif in action for the first time, which was really great. We got to see him use an interesting blue power. He grabbed the Abyss Herald by the neck, like he threw a noose around him and hung him up before he could escape. He has some kind of insane speed ability. Like, he literally blinked across the screen to get through that portal to pursue Lumine. Now, we know from the 1.3 quest line with Dainsleif that he was traveling partners with Lumine for sure, and Lumine immediately recognized him, even though she says that he is his enemy. And so I still think that that runs hand in hand again with the other theory that I ran in with in my Gnostic Chorus theory again, where the two of them were traveling companions and they differed too strongly over their feelings about how to treat the Abyssal Order. Dainsleif has no love for the individuals from the Abyssal Order. I guess in his eyes, they're a perversion of what was once his great people, but now they're gone. And he's not really able to cope with it. He's just going to try to disassemble them and under any means possible. He even recommended that you should continue, or that the traveler should continue to destroy any ruin guards that he sees, even though those ruin guards were once constructs of a nation that he was a member of. So he's come a long way. He's not interested in redemption for his people. He's more interested in, I don't want to say a cleansing at this point, but he's definitely not interested in allowing them to harm everybody around them. He doesn't care for the realm of the Seven. He doesn't care for the gods. He doesn't care for the Archons. He doesn't really appreciate that everyone in Teyvat worships the gods, but he doesn't want the Spiral Abyss to be able to do, you know, evil things to the lands of Teyvat. He doesn't want what's already happened to occur again. I think that he has a vested interest in preventing the destruction of the rest of Teyvat. But, and this is kind of my final note for this questline, he escaped through the portal. Like I said, he used that blink ability and he disappeared through the portal immediately. He was gone. And so with that said, he forgot about their original objective. That original objective, they returned to the altar to destroy the statue of the Seven that was repurposed by the Spiral Abyss, or the Abyssal Order, and he left. But then so did Aether and Paimon afterwards. It's still there. They haven't prevented the plan that they wanted to enact. And not only did they not prevent the plan by destroying that Statue of the Seven, they left it there, and Dainsleif was supposedly holding on to the eye himself, the eye of the first Field Tiller. If Dainsleif isn't powerful enough to overcome both Lumine and the Abyss Herald on his own, and it did seem like Lumine's power is more than enough, to at least keep Dainsleif on his toes, they could have what they need to turn Osiel against everyone. Not that Osiel particularly enjoys playing nice anyways, but they do have what they need if they can defeat Dainsleif and take it from him. So I think that might have been a little bit short-sighted on Dainsleif's part. He jumped through the portal. He pursued her. I'm guessing he's been looking for her for a while. That's where we've pretty much left off at this point. Things have gotten pretty shaky. Dainsleif may have delivered the thing that they needed to make their plans work straight into their hands. Aether now knows that his sister is alive. We know that the twins are immortal beings. And we know that the gods, supposedly the Seven, partook in the destruction of Conria, which was indeed 500 years ago, the same amount of time the twins were separated. We learned a lot this week. It was a pretty big set of reveals. I think it's going to be a little while before we get anything that's this big. I think it's probably not going to be until probably in Azuma, where anything could possibly come close to anywhere nearly rivaling the kind of reveals that we just got out of this. And I think most people probably wouldn't have put money on, you know, this quest line being so pivotal as it ended up being. But it did end up delivering to us some of the most noteworthy story aspects that we've had since the game released. So that's pretty amazing. Silverberg, welcome to the Adventurers Guild. Thanks for becoming a member. Make sure to send me a direct message over on the Discord so I can get your get you access to the supporters Discord going into or coming out of the stream. Anyways, guys, that's going to do it for me on this stream. I've actually run over my time that I wanted to allot for this a little bit too far as it is. Hopefully everybody enjoyed the content. If you have any feedback on any of the stuff that you heard on this, or if you wanted to share your theories about what you experienced during this quest line or what you think might be happening with this quest line, feel free to share it in the comments. Make sure to toss a like on the video, and if you're not a subscriber already, please do that. It really does help me out with the YouTube algorithm. It's been a steady struggle for me with that lately, and I'm always trying to find ways to bring newer, higher quality, more compelling content to everybody. So all of your support really does help me out, and I really do appreciate it, guys. Have a great night. See you in the next one.